It's time for Cutting Edge Consciousness with Freeman Michaels and Barnett Bain. Thought-provoking discussions and bold ideas from the edge of possibility.
And welcome to Cutting Edge Consciousness. Freeman Michaels here.
With Barnett Bain. Good moment, everyone. Yeah, good moment.
Woohoo!
It's starting to become a habit, that, huh?
It's a pattern.
I like it.
It's a good one.
You know, it's sort
you
of...
You can keep that
it
one.
It kind of sets me up. It's a sort of... It's kind of my audio version of a sigil. You know what a sigil is?
I don't.
A sigil is a empowered symbol. It's usually...
What's that come out of? What
it's
tradition?
It's non-traditional. I mean, I think it's, okay. it's... Or it's supra-traditional. I mean, a sigil is... A sigil is like a symbol that either can be found in nature or you can create it and you endow it with a certain kind of, like, remember those waxed seals that people would close letters with
or
that a sigil is often affixed to the great seal of lawmakers when they would ceremonially embellish a law or a charter, they would affix a seal to it. So it is endowed with a certain kind of sense of a meaning that it is assigned to it. And the repeated use of it serves to reinforce an intention. There are lots of ways that that plays out, including even in our neural maps. But we use it to reinforce an intention and to signal something to ourselves and to the world and to the mysteries. And so I love the use of that opening.
Yeah.
Because it sets me up for an adventure on air.
Yeah. Well, so one more time, because I want to, if I take the SAT again, I'm a little old for this. I want to be able to get that one right. How do you spell this word?
S-I-G-E-L.
Okay.
Sigil.
I like it.
So it's a it's an audio sigil. I don't know if there's such a thing, but I may have just invented the audio sigil.
Which is just a little ritual that we do.
It's a little ritual that I like to do, and it puts me in the groove, and it lines me up with... My best practices when it comes to the radio.
I love it.
Yeah.
The moment.
Good moment.
Good moment. Well, we should say good moment to our guest because I'm sure they'll have something to add.
What a coinkydink. What a coinkydink. What a coinkydink. Yeah, I think our guest may just have something to say about ritual and habits and
sigils.
Sigils and ceremonial practices.
Beautiful.
So we're thrilled today to have my really, really good buddy, Chris Attwood, many of our listeners are going to recognize that name as the co-author of the New York Times bestseller, The Passion Test.
Love The Passion Test.
You ever take The Passion Test?
Yes.
You have?
Yeah.
What about Spence, cool. Our producer? You ever take The Passion Test, buddy? No. All right. Well, you got a homework assignment for next
session.
We're going to talk
Everyone
later.
Everyone should take The Passion Test.
So together with his business partner and my girlfriend, Janet Bray Attwood, he also has a new book out. And we're going to talk a little bit about his new book in just a couple of minutes. But in the meantime,
say
hello.
Do you want to say what it is?
No, I don't.
Oh, okay, fine.
I don't give away everything. Hand out a little bit at a time.
Welcome to the show, Chris.
Thank you so much, you guys. It's kind of fun to listen to you both, I have to say.
Well, we're so glad to have you with us, and I know
fun is a practice, by the way. We're committed to it.
That's a ritual.
A good practice. It's my number two passion, I have to say. So I must be in the right place.
It's my number one criteria. I devise seven criteria for decision making because at one point in my life, fairly recently, too many things were coming in, and I had to determine what's the criteria for whether or not I say yes to something. And number one on my list was fun. And there's six others, but that was the first.
It's a great criteria. And I loved hearing about Barnett's sigil. In case
did you know that word, by the way, Chris?
Recognize it. It's also called sigil. Sigil. Sometimes.
Sigil.
Oh,
but I'm Canadian.
Smart.
Yeah, you're Canadian.
I'm Canadian.
So you pronounce things
so they get a free pass, the Canadians.
Now, I'm going to fess up that I don't know that in Canada they say sigil or sigil, but I'm just hiding behind
just
that. I stay with it. Anytime there's something like that comes up, I pull out my passport.
Right. That's right. Instantly forgiven. I love it. So let's talk about this because for me, again, conscious, practices, you know, ritualized expressions of something that has behind it, beneath it, I don't know what the right word is, an intent, you know, with some sense of vision, a sense of my passion, is really powerful. And I love the idea. I haven't read the new book. I will, though. Just know that.
I'll sell you a copy.
I know. Read it after you have the guy on the show. It's brilliant. But, you know, I love the premise of this book.
Well, thank you for that. Now, I'm going to say the name of the book since it has, I'm going to let the cat out of the bag.
Okay, do it. Anyway, drum roll.
Yeah. We love drum
Our
roll.
Producer's asleep.
But it's called Your Hidden Riches, Unleashing the Power of Ritual to Create a Life of Meaning and Purpose. And that's why I think you guys probably are talking about ritual so much. But, if you know, you get so much what we're talking about. You know, some people hear ritual and they think religious practices or superstition or they think it's habits, and we're not talking about any of those things, although there's beautiful rituals in the religious traditions all around the world. When we use ritual, what we're talking about is conscious, intentional practices. You choose to make habitual because they improve your life.
These are conscious habits.
Yeah.
These are conscious habits, and I think it bears saying that almost everything that we do in our lives is informed with a certain energy of the habitual.
Yeah.
And the degree to which we can become conscious of that, we then begin to, we are empowered to make choice around it and change our lives. And then the next overlay of that is, well, then let's change our lives in favor of something that is more empowering to the self and to others and more gracious and more productive and more fun. And in order to become intimate with these new choices, you begin to consciously choose out new habits. And
right.
And hence we have the sort of ritual piece.
Yeah, absolutely.
You just did his job for him.
I did. So what else we could talk about?
you should bring Barnett on the road with you. When you get tired, you can just send him out there.
I want you to know, I've studied with Chris Attwood, and I'm not saying that tongue-in-cheek. Chris has...
Well, and you read the book, too, so you cheated.
I did read the book. But he's also... I've been schooled by Chris Attwood in many areas.
Well, and vice versa, I have to say. So
thank you.
Beautiful. Yeah. So what is the ritual, the newest...
That you are practicing.
That you're currently practicing. And what's the intention behind it?
Well, the newest ritual, that's an interesting question.
You haven't heard that one.
Or what's the next ritual? What's the one that you want to come up with right now that you want to commit to?
Well, I love the one that Barnett did. You know, one of the most powerful and useful ways people can use rituals is when they're at a point where they want to perform at their best, where they need to stay focused. I love the example of World Cup soccer player Leighton Barnes. He plays for the British team. And if you ever watch him play, every time he goes out on the playing field, he'll kneel down, untie his shoes, and tie his shoes again. You think, well, why does he do that? Sort of a crazy ritual. But what it does is it separates his ordinary daily life from this time on the field where he has to be at his very best, where he has to stay focused even with thousands of people screaming in the stands and millions of people watching him on television. So it gets him in a mental and emotional state where he can really be there at the top of his game. And obviously, that's the whole purpose of Barnett's sigil, right?
Yes,
I love that. I'll tell you why I love that, because there are sort of two sides to the example you just gave. There is the side where it's conscious, it's intentional, and it's got, and you understand what you're intending to create with the ritual.
Right.
Then there is the sort of, let's call it left-hand side of the page, or maybe the shadow expression, which is where we become superstitious. We begin to, and I don't know if you and Barnett do this, but I do sometimes find myself tripping over things I do from a fear perspective.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that, because it's really worth...
We would never do that. Chris and I would yeah,
you
never
guys are way too conscious. But a schmuck like me... No. I do. I mean, admittedly, I'm not proud of it, but there are moments where I find myself going, well, I'll do this just because I don't want to... You know, it's crazy. And I want to be able to make empowered choices and create ritual versus default to rituals because I don't want to be in trouble with this imaginary spooky god type projection.
I love that. So, you know, there's this principle that we taught first in the passion test, that what you put your attention on grows stronger in your life, right?
Absolutely.
And so fear is just vividly imagining that what you don't want to happen is going to happen, right?
Surely.
And so the way we always talk about how do you deal with things like fear or when you have problems or obstacles in your way, and for me it's always to change the focus from the problem or the thing that I'm afraid is going to happen to what I can do about it. What's the solution? What are the possible ways in which I can move forward or that I can go around, over, under, between it? And when it comes to fear, I think you can use ritual as a way of overcoming fear. And when you do it because out of a feeling of obligation, I would suggest it's not going to have a lot of value for you.
Hmm.
And the reason for that is that what makes rituals valuable is when they have personal meaning. You know, lots of us grew up, right, with rituals from our parents, and we were just sort of dragged along the way, you know, the Thanksgiving dinner where all the family's together, but no one talks to each other, and no one really wants to be there. They'd rather be having Thanksgiving
well,
on their
own. Well, the intention's out of the room at that point. The intention's not there. It's just habit.
That's it.
Yeah.
And when it's meaningless, then you're going to reject it because it doesn't have value for you. So the key and important thing about any ritual is that you design it so that it has personal meaning for you. And it doesn't matter if it makes sense to anyone else. And can I give you a really fun example?
Please.
So we all know Simon Cowell, probably, right?
Yeah.
Star of American Idol, Britain's Got Talent, multimillionaire producer. You know what his morning ritual is?
What?
He climbs a tree every day.
Nice.
Wow. How do you know that, Chris?
Yeah, have you been hanging out with him in the woods? What's going on?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, it's one of the reasons we say rituals are the unspoken secret of the world's most successful people, because most of them don't talk about them because they consider them to be way too personal, right?
Hmm. What is your morning ritual?
Well, I want to know why he climbs a tree before we go to that.
Yeah, I think it's important to understand why he climbs a tree.
Yeah, because that's just odd.
That's a good question, and that's a good question.
Yeah. It really ties in again to this point that it doesn't matter if rituals are meaningful to anybody else or if they think they're stupid or ridiculous or silly. It matters that they're meaningful to you. And when you think about Simon Cowell, do you think this guy's kind of busy in his life?
Yeah.
Do you think that there are a lot of people demanding his time and that he's got a lot of people putting pressure on him from one side or another?
Yes.
Do you think that there's probably not very often that he just gets to let go, feel free, feel like a kid?
Yes.
And do you think he probably likes to get exercise and fresh air?
Yes.
You got him all right.
There you go, man. So,
if the SAT was
easy. You got him all right.
It didn't have words like sigil.
You got an 800.
I would have been fine.
You got a 700.
I would have been to Harvard.
You got a 700 score.
Oh, we got to do easier tests from now on.
But so doesn't it make sense that somebody is like overly busy dealing with tons of stuff under a lot of pressure, that it might be really cool to just feel like a kid, get some fresh air, get some exercise, and have some fun in the day to like start off from that place, you know?
Especially if the tree's in your office. So I want to know, what is your early morning ritual?
Sure. Well, I'm happy to share that. You know, I think Barnett knows. I know Barnett knows, but I'm a father of a 6-year-old, a 3-year-old, and a 6-month-old.
Well, you're a busy guy. You and Simon both need trees. you're chasing the toddler up the tree.
Or you need a TV in your room.
That's one of those not-so-helpful rituals. Go on.
So, a lot of the rituals in my day when I'm at home revolve around things that I do with my kids. And so I have my own morning rituals. You know, I get up in the morning, and like everyone, I have my morning routine. But one of the things that I do that I think is easy for anyone to do taking a page from Ben Franklin's playbook. You know, Ben Franklin, when he got up in the morning, he'd say, what good will I do today?
Oh, I love that.
And at the end of the day, he'd ask himself, what good did I do today?
Hmm.
And so when I take a couple of minutes before I get out of bed and say, what do I want to create today?
Mm-hmm.
And then I just think about, what are my intentions for the day? And then usually when I'm taking a shower, you know, these are called everyday rituals, by the way, and everyday rituals don't have to take a lot of time, and they're not like another thing to add to your to-do list. So while I'm taking a shower, I'll just be thinking about all the things that I have to feel grateful for.
Mm, that's nice.
I also like good stuff going on in my life.
You know, kids love ritual. I mean, it makes sense
they
that you wrote this book with the three kids, right? Because especially little kids, because they like routine and they like ritual, and they love when there's meaning to it. They can get really into the, you know, the backstory of why we're doing something. So,
Well, it makes them feel safe and secure.
Totally.
You know,
totally makes me feel safe and secure.
I have to tell you this story.
Wait a second. You have to wait
for a commercial.
We're going to, because we have to pay for the program. When we come back, well, after this story is prepaid, we're going to come back. And Chris Attwood is going to tell us a story. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Cutting Edge Consciousness, thought-provoking discussions and bold ideas from the edge of possibility.
Hey, we're back on Cutting Edge Consciousness with Chris Attwood, and Chris has been holding a story for us
through
the whole commercial break, and this story is now ready.
It's like going through a tunnel. He's holding his breath. Go, Chris.
The story is cooked. Go.
All right. Well, this story is about my six-year-old. Before the break, we were talking about, my morning ritual, what will I create today? And when I take her to school, on the way to school, we play either the gratitude game or the appreciation game, and we really, with the kids, we make it into games, you know? Who can get the most gratitudes? Or, the appreciation game, it's I love and appreciate you and why I appreciate that about you. And she loves playing those things. But when we get to school, then I ask her, so, honey, what are you going to create today? What are your three intentions? Now, my wife, I'm in the U.S. in Chicago right now. We live in Germany. And I was just talking with my wife this morning. And she said, I have to tell you what happened. Because this morning I asked Sophie, our daughter, what were her intentions this morning, and she said, I want to have fun, which she always does. I want to play with my best friends, and I want the weather report to be wrong and that there for the sun to come out and be really sunny and shiny today. And my wife said, well, you know, she thought, well, she'll probably get the first two, but maybe not the third one, you know? And she goes home, and about half an hour after she gets home, the clouds part, the sun comes out, and there's this radiant, brilliant day. She said it was the most beautiful day they've had in ages. And the weather report said it was supposed to be cloudy, rainy all day long. And what was so cute is that she said, I went and picked up our daughter. And when I got her, I said, honey, look what happened. She said, what? Because she'd completely forgotten that she'd set this intention. And so what we're reinforcing with our daughter is that she can actually create the world that she likes to have. Maybe she will get the sun, maybe she won't, but by consciously creating intentions her day, each day, that we're drawing her attention again and again to how can she create what she wants. And then at the end of the day, we say, what did you create? She goes through them, and she gets five kisses for every intention that came through.
Ooh, that's a good deal that you get.
Yeah,
you
absolutely
got the better side of that deal. I love that. That's fun. That is
awesome.
Beautiful. That's I'm going to share one with you, too. Mm. So I have a sister, my dear, wonderful sister, Linda. Hi, Linda, if you're listening. And sometimes when I go and I visit Linda, my older sister, it is very easy for me to get triggered and to fragment into patterns that are 40, 50 years old.
Funny how that happens when we go home.
And so when I'm about to go and see Linda, when I step out of my car, I have a screen, like a screen door. And I imagine a screen door in front of me, and I step right through the screen. I push myself right through the screen.
Mm.
And the screen takes out all the gunk. All the gunk gets left on the screen as I pass through the other side. All the stuff that might trigger me, all the oversensitivity, all the attachments to the past, all the need to be right in that adolescent way. I just leave all of that stuff slimed on the screen. I move through the screen, and it works pretty good. Right, Lynn?
Yeah, right. I'll tell you what I love about that, because I'd like to share as well. We were talking earlier about the fear and how, you know, compelling, or I think you used the word vivid, the fear can get.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, of course, we all know the sort of story that it's either fear or love, and the way the fear gets resolved is by loving the fear, is by actually being okay with the fact that part of me, as Barnett sort of talking in terms of fragments, part of me is scared, part of me is overwhelmed, part of me doesn't know how to handle this. What the pattern, the practices, the rituals are so helpful for, if we have a ritual that we... And from my experience, it has to be something we do regularly. It can't be something we just say for when we're, you know, triggered, because it won't work. In that sort of refractory period, we can't just pull it out. It has to be something that's pretty automated, that we do regularly, but then can really be an empowered response to the part of us that's scared, right? For me, clearing breaths, I've been doing that for 20 plus years, just, you know, breathe in and out, and, you know, and inhale, you know, self-acceptance and let go of self-judgment. And I just do three of them. And whatever the situation is, it creates kind of an interrupt, right? It creates a space for me to sort of go, okay, what do I want to do? Versus riding that fear, you know, vividly into a crash, into something that really isn't how I want to show up in the world, similar to kind of what Barnett was sharing.
Mm. Yeah, great rituals, I have to say, both of you. And
because we want to be in the next book.
Yeah. <that's right. laughs> We want to go on the road with you and see all these cool places you're hanging out in.
I want to go to Chicago.
Yeah, how fun is that?
You know, Freeman, the point that you're bringing up is really a great one, because rituals are a way of repatterning. You know, we all have patterns, mental, emotional patterns. You know, Barnett was talking about them in terms of how he responds to his sister. You know, we have these old patterns. And the repetition that is involved with ritual that you were talking about is a way of changing those patterns. And as, of course, we know that the patterns result from the way our brain gets structured. These neural pathways become neural highways as we're growing up. And it's often difficult to change those. And so rituals are a way of changing those patterns that don't serve us, those bad habits, if you will, that now we're ready to step into a different way of living. And by ritualizing our responses, ritualizing, just as you were saying, ritualizing the way we choose to appear, and Barnett's example, great one, if I choose to step through the screen that wipes away all those old ways of being, and the power of our awareness is such that intention often is enough to create a whole different experience.
Yeah, and for me, the language is, how do I want to be, for example, with the part of me that's scared? Because so much of my early attraction to the work that we all do, and I'll call it self-help, I know it isn't, but I mean, that's just the initial term back in 1980, whatever it was, when I first found this sort of way of thinking, was I thought that something had to be fixed, right? So it was still sort of a reaction to the fear, which we all three know is just going to make the fear, you know, more pronounced. So the long journey to where I, in a clear moment, can choose, how do I want to be with the part of me that's scared, or the part of me that's, you know, insecure, or the part of me that, you know, reacts to I don't have a sister, but my brother.
You can react to my sister.
I probably would. We're close enough friends that I'd probably have all the, I'd have to do the screen door thing too.
I think she's free tomorrow night.
Yeah, that's right. But that becomes, in my mind, you know, the beauty and the grace of this is we really can use which ritual to relate to aspects of ourselves, you know, as opposed to, and I don't know if you make this distinction, as opposed to, again, moving into not superstition, but a way where we're trying to fix, like, oh, I can do this, then I won't be that way. Well, okay, good luck with that. But there is an empowered response to the part of us that acts that way.
Absolutely. And, you know, in our book, what we talk about is everyday rituals and ceremonial rituals. And each has a different purpose. What we've been talking about here is kind of everyday rituals, things that you can incorporate easily and that have the effect that you're talking about, Freeman. And the other side of it, ceremonial rituals are really a way of stepping beyond fear instead of saying, you know, I'm going to do this to appease some higher power somewhere that could get angry with me, rather to use ceremonial rituals as a way of connecting with the deepest part of our own nature, our own self, where that higher power and what we call me, us, you know, is not something separate. And what we've found is that ceremonial rituals in cultural traditions all over the world, and, you know, I find it's not an accident, I don't think, that you find these rituals, even though the rituals are different, they exist in every culture, and they have seven different aspects that we talk about in the book.
Go.
You got it. Seven. We're ready.
So quick.
I'm writing.
Quick. I'll go through them quickly. And ceremonial rituals can be long and involved. You know, sometimes they last for days, sometimes even for weeks, or they can be very brief. I do a ceremonial ritual every day when I begin before I begin work that lasts about 3 minutes, you know, so it can be short or long depending on what you like. But the first piece is intention. You'll find in rituals all over the world that there's an intention piece, and we've been talking about. The second, preparation and purification. When you're doing a ceremonial ritual, generally it involves different elements, and it's a matter of consciously creating a sacred space, cleaning the area, making ready for it. The third one is the use of symbols, and this is the sigil or sigil that Barnett was talking about at the beginning, that, you know, things that represent to us something that's meaningful. It could be something spiritual, or it could simply be a great teacher or members of our family or a mentor.
Crystal, piece of twig on the ground.
A piece of twig on the ground. Something that has, you know, it reminds me, I just was with my stepfather's family last weekend, and there was his son was wearing this rock, and I thought, oh, there must be some great symbolism to that. what was valuable, was symbolic to him about that rock, is it connected him to nature, and he loved it. Mm. Nothing greater than that.
That's, you know, kind of pretty.
Yeah.
It's funny, because I have this thing on my wrist that Sister Jenna, who's a friend of ours, a Brahma Kumari nun, tied onto my wrist in some ritual. And it was very funny, because when she put it on, what the blessing was...
It actually says, if lost, return to the Brahma Kumari.
You'll drop this guy off at the local Brahma
Kumari. Exactly. Prepaid postage.
Yeah. No, but what's crazy about it is I've totally forgot what the meaning is. But, I mean, the time I was into it, this is now really old. This has been on my wrist for months now. But anyhow.
Well, we're missing the last three.
I know. We got to get there. We don't have three. We have four more. We had, intention, preparation, purification, and then creating symbols.
Yep.
Symbols. Go on.
Yeah. The fourth one is activating all the senses. That's why if you've ever participated in ceremonial ritual, you'll see often there are maybe flowers or beautiful colors, the drumming or music or, you know, all these candles, all these different things, incense that activate the senses, and they create a whole body experience so that the mind and emotions can really settle down, can go to a different state than our ordinary waking state. And then the fifth and sixth ones kind of go together. The fifth one is repetition. The fifth one is prescribed performance. Sixth one is repetition. So prescribed performance just means usually there is kind of an order in which you perform this ceremonial ritual, step by step by step. Repetition, you do it over and over again. We were talking about that. The value of those two things is that the mind and body, after having done it many times, are not so engaged in the performance of the ritual, which means that the mind is able to naturally go where it wants to go, which is to that spiritual core within us. We all have this, right? And so the ceremonial ritual really is for the purpose of allowing us to transcend our ordinary waking experience. And all of these aspects we've been talking about help to support that. And then the seventh and last one is invoking the unseen. And, of course, there are many ways of doing that. And I think we all recognize, right, that there's a lot of the parts of life that we can't experience with our senses. The ancient texts say 75% of life is beyond the reach of the senses. 25% can be seen. So invoking the unseen can be invoking a god or spirit or whatever, but it can also be as simple as I'm open to receiving help from wherever it may come.
This is really wonderful. I'm struck by something that creators know. You're a writer, so you know this well, that you probably have a ritual around your writing. Many writers that I know, many creators that I know, painters and poets and artists, musicians, they create a workspace.
Yeah.
They beautify it. They arrange it. They have one or two things. They may have flowers. They may have one or two pictures there. Sometimes they have an altar or a candle, or sometimes not. But it is always a place that is dedicated for work and work only. When they approach it, they approach it with an intention, and they approach it with a respect, and they sit down with a humility. And they open to the muses, they invoke the muses, and they do so with commitment, and they do so with routine, and they do so with practice, and they do so over and over and over again. And when you approach a workspace, like when you approach the radio mic, you drop into a very different relationship with the unseen.
I'm going to call it sacred. It's a sacred experience.
It's a ceremony.
It's a ceremony. But there's something also in the intention. I mean, when the intention is really fused, now I'm going to cross-reference here with passion. Mm-hmm. And there's this deep sense of commitment to what I'm wanting to create in the world. Then the whole experience becomes very sacred. You know, our lives can be really deep and profound.
Well, and it becomes real. I mean, it's a great point you're making, Freeman, because it does make it sacred and it becomes real. Rituals make things real. Mm. If you think about a wedding makes a marriage real. You know, it makes it something tangible, something we can relate to, something we can connect with. Why do people sit in a wedding and cry?
Or a commencement ceremony.
Commencement ceremony. All of those things. How about the inauguration of a president, you know?
I want to say something about the wedding.
A funeral.
Because we can keep coming up with examples, but the thing about the wedding...
Lunch.
Barnett's getting hungry. Well, that's a ritual, you know? The thing about the wedding is the repeating of the vows.
Yeah.
And, you know... look, I'm not prescribing marriage advice, though if it sounds like that, it's okay. The number one successful thing my wife and I have done is we created a vision with 28 things that we repeat.
You don't get to say them on air,
I'm not
all 28.
No. Seven, Chris and I would get a pass on the seven, but when it gets to
that's
28.
Four tranches of seven.
Well, I'll say the first one because it's really important.
Yep.
We play and have fun together.
Yeah.
And I'll say the second, just for context, is we relate.
You have to write in for the back 26.
We relate openly and honestly without fear of saying the wrong thing.
Yep.
And, you know, when we created this, it was a course we took because we love this stuff. I've been doing courses for, I don't know, 20 years, and I teach them, and I like them, and I take them. And we were required, it was 3 months long, to read it every night to each other. I would read one, she would read one, pass it back and forth. That ritual... Hmm. It set forward. That's what we're up to creating. And even though we don't read it every day now, I look at that and I say, wow, we really have embodied that. We really have stepped into that. Because, you know, Barnett, you said this earlier, it's an aspiring, right? Or maybe it was something you said off air, but I remember you saying, today at least, it's an aspiring. It's something we're aspiring to. And then one day we wake up and go, wow, we are it. Like, we've repeated it enough, and we've hopefully organized our choices enough around this that it's become real, what you were saying, Chris. Mm-hmm.
That's exactly it. The rituals make things real. And I love that example that you gave, Freeman, because it is true. The repetition of rituals like that, they repattern our mental and emotional experience of life and our physical experience as well. And ultimately our spiritual experience. So you bring all those things together, and what you find is that you're actually living this thing that at one time was just a concept. And that, and the way you do that is by ritual. And you know, I love the example you gave, Barnett, of, you know, because musicians and artists, writers, use ritual to spark their creativity. What's so cool is that business leaders use rituals to create cohesive teams and
say more
strong
about
corporate
that.
Culture.
Say a little more about that, an example for our listeners of a business leader using ritual to create a cohesive team.
Sure. Well, you know, the example I love is if anybody's ever watched when Steve Jobs was doing a product launch for Apple,
yeah,
total
yeah.
ritual. a complete ritual. The whole thing is lined out step by step by step by step. And he always wore the same black turtleneck shirt and the same jeans and the same sneakers.
He was the high priest of Apple.
Yeah, that's right. He was. Yeah. He was the high priest of Apple, man. I mean,
that's great. There's another great example. You know, to this day, before any Walmart store opens every morning, there is a staff cheer. My daughter's my daughter, who is now a 27-year-old woman, but when she was
Sophie,
my Sophie, yes, my Sophie, went to Waldorf school. So from preschool all the way through to high school, every morning their teacher would stand at the door and shake the hand of every pupil.
Oh, isn't that great?
So these sorts of particularly somatically engaged rituals are very, very potent. They're very, very powerful.
Hey, we have a ritual called commercial break. I hate to be this, but
it is.
But listen, we need to, before we let you go, Chris, we need to get the information for our audience.
About your hidden riches?
Well, about the book, of course, but also about where they can find, because I know you do workshops and things of that nature, where they can find, or where you're going to be next, because you're you know, traveling around a lot. Can you give us the website for the folks?
Sure. So I'm first going to say, right now through Saturday, we are giving some really wonderful special gifts to anyone who buys our book. Since it just came out on Tuesday, we're celebrating. And any listener who would like to go and get the book now can go to thehiddenriches.com. So T-H-E, hiddenriches.com/book.
Well, this airs on Saturday, so folks, when you hear this on Saturday, you got a little time. Get on it, because that's going to be a little shorter window than you're thinking.
And if you do it twice, you get two.
Right.
There you go. That's right. So thehiddenriches.com/book, and then there's a lot of content on thehiddenriches.com as well, and that's probably the best way. Thehiddenriches.com and thepassionatist.com is where people can find anything they want to know about us.
Great. And we hope that we can find you next time you are in the L.A. area and drag you into the studio, because it would be great to have you here in person next time.
I would love that.
We can
Thank
show that
so
we
much.
Know fun people.
We can make a ritual out of it. Every time you're in L.A., you visit us.
Chris, thank you for being with us. We love you. And big hug to the family.
Oh, so love you guys as well. Thank you so much, and I will give that hug.
Okay. And for those of you listening, stay tuned, because after the break, Barnett and I will be back
to talk about Chris.
Talk about Chris and to wrap things up here on Cutting Edge Consciousness. Stay with us.
Welcome back to Cutting Edge Consciousness, thought-provoking discussions and bold ideas from the edge of possibility.
And welcome back to Cutting Edge Consciousness. Freeman Michaels here with Barnett Bain.
Oh, it's always great to have Chris around.
It was
great.
Fun.
Yeah, it's fun.
You know, we should make a ritual of hanging out with people we like.
I thought we do.
We do. I know what to say. But,
I thought we do.
Yeah, no, we do. That's actually a big component. It's interesting, because people asked, how do we get our guests? And I said, mostly it's people we like. That's the key criteria. It's true, too. I mean,
but every once in a while, one slips through.
Well, and look, every once in a while,
but we like them by the time we're finished.
Well, that's the goal, you know? I mean, mostly, you know, everyone's probably get a dud, but you know, mostly.
Yeah.
You know what, this off topic from the ritual, but it depends on how they show up. And I'm going to say this, even though it's a little tricky. If they have an agenda, like to sell a product, it doesn't help very much. But if they come on to share what it is that they have, that they enjoy doing, and or just meeting us at the level of what are we going to co-create,
what are we going to talk about,
then it's really fun, and it's great to meet them. The challenge, and look, maybe I'm talking about myself, because most of the time I am, you know, not knowing it, when I'm sort of seeing something I don't necessarily love in the world, is the part of me that has, you know, an agenda. And the part of me that sort of, to use the landmark language, running a racket, right? To, you know, but anyhow. But it's great, because what I love about Chris Attwood is he just shows up offering and giving what he has to share. And it's so valuable. And it's just so great.
Yeah, Chris is beautiful. He's a light.
So you're hitting,
literally actually
you're hitting
you
riches.
could put him on the hood of your car and drive blind in the night, and he'll
light it up.
He'll light it up 100 feet out.
That's great. That's great. I've never seen him with his kids, but I imagine he's
fun. It's
dad.
Beautiful.
Yeah, he's into it. I love the rituals. I mean, the what's our little gratitude practice? You know, who does that with her kids too? Is Susan Leahy, our friend Susan.
Mm-hmm.
She does that with her kids. A little, what are we grateful for? And they have like a little cheer even, which is
woo-hoo!
Fun. Happy. Wait a minute. I can't remember it.
That's probably a good thing.
Well, when I'm at the house, I do the cheer with them, you know? I'm in the groove. So, yeah, why not?
I'm grateful for that.
We should have a cheer. Kind of get consciousness cheer.
Yeah, you want to you want to do something spontaneous? Go ahead.
No, I don't.
Think of it as an improv. Yes, and?
Yes, and. That's a good one, but that's not a cheer.
Yes, and?
No.
So you were saying something earlier that I'd like to return to. You were talking about facing certain challenges in the family that are story-based.
Hmm.
And, do you mind if I paraphrase it? So you were talking about a challenge that's coming up for Bella, you know, the listeners.
That, this wasn't on air, though. This was
it was off air,
talking.
Yeah,
that's fine. You can
so
talk about that.
You're talking about the Bella, listeners, is Freeman's wonderful
nine-year-old
daughter, who is facing something at school right now. And
well, we can say she didn't get invited to something.
She didn't get invited to a party.
And it's brutal. She's really upset about it.
And
her friends did, and she
it's
was
tough.
Excluded.
So we were talking
it's
about
tough for everybody. Honestly.
It is. We're talking about the nature of it's in the nature of this that parents we always respond by being protective, and we are always very concerned about the well-being and how can we fix it and how can we explain it and how can we spin it and how can we spin it to ourselves and how can we spin it to our kids. And we have these big agendas around that are ritualized. They're habitual behaviors.
Definitely.
And so we were having this discussion.
Yeah, no, and the big revelation for me was, again, we project onto our kids. I mean, and sadly, we nobleize it. Like, I'm just doing this for my daughter. You know, the truth is, I was really hurt. You know, I was mad at the parents. Like, how were they thinking? I took it really personal. And even
I thought we had created such a nice community.
Oh, and yeah. And after the Isabella was fine with it, or whether she was or wasn't, I don't know. I was still reeling. Like, she'd let it go. She'd moved on to something else.
But what's interesting is if she hadn't let it go.
Mm. Well, my theory is that I brought it back again.
Well, yeah, but...
Go on.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, but if let's say you brought it back again. So, again, it just starts from zero, and you belly up to the real stakes. And the real stakes are, my child is is an emotional disturbance, and do I have, as a parent, the spaciousness to be present for her without losing myself? Can I be present for her while she goes through what nine-year-olds go through in an area of disappointment without trying to fix it, without trying to spin it, without trying to... can I be with my own dissonance, with my
that's
own internal nine-year-old and 20-year-old and 30-year-old?
Yeah,
can I be with my own fragments without... be present enough to make a space to allow her to go through what she's going through.
That's a big aspiration.
That is a ritual. That is a ceremony. That is a... In the conversation with Chris, we alluded to one of the... Or I know I did, and I had an intention, and now I'm showing my hand. We talked about commencement.
Hmm.
The ritualization, you know, this sort of institutional bar mitzvah that happens. It's the end of one period of life and a doorway into something, into what is next. Can we be the commencement for each other moment to moment, particularly when it calls us to end our own relationships with our own stories through a ceremony, through a ritual, and initiate a new beginning for ourselves in the in the umbrage, in the shadow, light or the shadow or dark shadow of that umbrage, people around us are affected. Mm. So in this case, beautiful little Bella, in the umbrage, in the light shadow of being able to just be with my own stories and not try and fix or spin or explain and hold the space for her to go through her stuff. What a permission that is being granted to another person, and what a commencement.
Mm. I love that. There's a lot to be appreciative of in the conversation Jasmine and I have been having. I mean, some of it has been some story creating, but, you know, thankfully we both are wise enough to go, we don't really want to go down that path. We don't want to create that story. And so, you know, or we can hold it as a story, but not the only story. There's more than one.
We want to turn it into a shaggy dog. Isn't it? We don't have to keep putting chapters on that story. No.
And, you know, there is a point in time to put it down and let it go for a minute. It's okay. You know, I have a friend, dear friend, they rush to therapy often, like something happens. And Jazz and I are talking about that too. We're saying like, okay, look, at the point that everything becomes an emotional crisis, you know, does that become a way where you're setting up emotional crisis? Like that's the new pattern. Like we have
some of it's developmental.
Yeah.
I mean, it's we don't sort of skip a space. So I don't know who you're speaking about, and I don't know whether they are leaning into a psychological awareness on the integrative side of it, or whether they have pushed through, they've gotten as much as they can get from that, and now are relying on it as a crutch. So I don't know that, but it is everything is developmental, and one doesn't put the clutch in stories before, you know, you can't do that before you move through move through an understanding of yourself as a psychological being.
Yeah.
And driven by emotions that you don't understand. There is, you know, there's a rush to broom, in our community for sure, to broom aside all psychological investigation in favor of coaching. What's next? What's your action plan?
And, no, you're not wrong about that.
So I'm not, that's not to say that psychology is a panacea and is the be all and the end all, but there are balances for everything because they're
balances.
All developmental
there
and they're
balances.
All per every individual.
Yeah.
Where am I in my own growth and what
that's
will
right.
serve me?
Yeah, no, that's right. And look, there there was a time where we needed some support for one of our, I only have one older child.
One of our older child.
we sent Josh to somebody. It was so great, and it was so helpful. It was a short period of time. He was struggling, and it was so great for him to have that safety and that warmth of this man who was, you know, counseling him. And it was such the right decision. So what I guess I want to say about this is clearly there's examples of where we need some support here, and there's other examples where we can make it bigger than it has to be. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not dismissing mm-hmm. that this is a major blow to her. You know, it feels like a betrayal. She thought she was included, and then she didn't get an invitation. And it, trust me, it's been very, very difficult. And then difficult for us, mom and me, you know, Jasmine and I, to like work through all of our experiences of not being included. We've come to the end of the show. So what we want to do now is say goodbye.
Bye.
And we'll pick this up on the other side at some point because it's an ongoing conversation.
Thanks always for being with us.
Yep.